Hello， 观众朋友们，大家好，欢迎来到我们本次的家庭区块链论坛，非常感谢大家这个耐心的等待。那我们现在呢，正式开始我们的区块链讲座。那我们今天呢，其实这个讲座的主要目的呢，是给大家科普一下这个区块链的知识。那这次讲座呢，是由两家公司这个联手举办的。大家看到大屏幕上写的 Nebula AI 是主办方之一啊。那这个先给大家介绍一下 Nebula AI 呢，就是顾名思义啊，它这个是一个人工智能和区块链相结合的这样一个公司。那它具体的行业应用呢，光儿我们的 CEO 会和大家解释啊。那还有一家公司呢，就是 Linkcoin。那 Linkcoin 呢，主要做的是这个线上的一个用 currency 去购买这个虚拟货币的这样一个平台。那他们最新的推出了 ESB， 那这个 ESB 呢，其实就是用这个虚拟货币去购买美股这样一个平台。那我们的第一位speaker 呢是这个 Nebula AI 的 CEO 以及 co-founder Charles。那 Charles 呢，他是这个。Charles 是 ABIGM 蒙特利尔 IT 机构的创始人，先后就职于 IBM、SAP、Autodesk、Expedia、Paysafe， 以及他是这个 Paysafe 核心项目的团长。他是复旦电子工程学士，加拿大 Concordia 硕士。Charles majored in electronic engineering at Fudan University and obtained his master's degree at Concordia University in electrical and computer engineering.Previously, he worked in SAP, Autodesk, Expedia, and Paysafe. He is an active thought leader in the North American blockchain community for many years. In 2017, Charles founded Nebula AI, Inc. and is committed to the development of the blockchain technology as well as AI. So let's welcome our first speaker, CEO and co-founder of Nebula AI, Charles.
Everybody for coming here. Today is the event to show the introduction about the blockchain, the industry, as well as some applications. Another topic will be for people who are interested to buy Bitcoin or other cryptocurrency, as well as developing their own applications on top of blockchain infrastructure framework. And our Nebula AI, as the name it is focused on building a decentralized.Artificial intelligence blockchain framework, so which enable people to running their AI applications using the AI resource as well as converting their mining hash power to AI computing. So, because today, like we have lots of people from different region, different groups, so this event will be presented in two different languages, both English and Chinese. Hi, 各位。欢迎大家来到今天的加拿大东部地区区块链论坛，我是这次活动的主要的组织者之一，和 Linkcoin 一起来组织这次论坛。我们的主要目的这次是给大家一个关于区块链的入门的介绍和如何购买你们的第一个数字货币。另外，我们会介绍一下在区块链上面各行各业的应用。以及人工智能是如何跟区块链结合在一起的。那么我们在稍后的环节中，两家公司都会有一个比较短的 demo 环节来展示我们已经取得一些成绩和成就。 OK, so like we already present myself a little bit. Now this is what I have done before. I've been working in the industry over 12 yearsAnd I have been starting my own company since 5 years ago, major in big platform development. I've been involved in blockchain industry for 3 years. We started from research in blockchain with the Fabric, with Ethereum and Bitcoin. So more interesting that we found that it will be a revolution to changing the traditional business model to blockchain business. So, 我本人已经在软件行业有超过12年的从业历史。我们在5年前与加拿大蒙特利尔创立了我们自己的公司。我们在这个行业经过了很多的行业应用，建设过很多的软件平台。我们发现，在传统的行业，包括一些成熟的互联网行业，在转变成现在的区块链行业中，拥有巨大的优势，并且可以给我们现在的已经发展到目前的已经成熟的互联网行业带来一些新的元素和新的推动力。Yeah, so basically from nowadays, we can group our blockchain application in 4 different groups. It can be in banking and finance, business, government, and other industries. So those 4 major groups of people can implement their blockchain solutions. Accordingly, these different industries, they have different characteristics. So basically, that you cannot say that you're just using one technology to do everything. That's something won't work. So during this topic, we'll describe what kind of challenge will be encountered in these 4 groups and what kind of solution will be possibly applied. So first of all, Wave is the most interesting place we can use blockchain.首先我们想说的就是在区块链行业，我们是可以把它分成4大组的。第一组是银行业和金融业，第二组是政府机构，第三组是一些商业机构和其他的一些产业。这些其他产业可能会包括一些大数据、人工智能，都会被归定在这些产业。 So we start with the banking and the financeSo there are 4 groups which is, we have been touching before during our business and also my previous working experience. Previously, I was working in PaySafe, a payment company who sold to Blackstone with $4 billion. So I was the team lead in that building, major in finance department. So we have been saying there are huge opportunities in the cross-border paymentKYC and trading platform and also insurance. So before that, nowadays, all the department, when they processing all these transactions, you always have the central place, like the ledger, to save all your information. And when you submitted your applications, actually towards processing by a central company or third-party organizations. But with blockchain, it's different. You don't have a central application, and you don't have third parties. Basically, the trust is distributed across the blockchain. So which means when you have problems, when you have something happen, you won't be attacked by a central place because it's decentralized. There's not a single point for you to attack. So that's the biggest difference from centralized and decentralized economy. And blockchain is the solution for decentralized solution. 就是说在我们现在的银行行业，我们因为我之前是在 PaySafe 这家加拿大的公司工作，它是蒙特利尔一家公司，后来扩张到全球，最近以40亿美金被黑石投资所收购。我是他们部门的一个项目主导。所以说在那里面我经历了这中间的很多的步骤，比如说跨境的支付，比如说 know your customer， 就是你在做金融服务的时候你都需要知道你的客户是谁，还有一些交易平台和保险业，这些都是非常适合区块链改造的金融传统金融行业。那么在我们的金融行业里面，目前的解决方案总是有一个中央的账本，你的所有的信息都记录在中央账本上，然后呢，总归有一些第三方的平台来提供这些反欺诈，又比如说你的风险控制，又以及一些评估报告。那么在区块链世界里面，你不会依赖一个单个的中央的这些处理账本，它是一个分布式账本， 然后呢，你也不是一定要相信某些第三方的平台来做评估，这是一个巨大的不同，因为它不存在，因为你是一个中央的部分，当你被攻击的时候，你无处可申诉。那么在去中心化平台，你总有地方可以找到依据说，这个不一定是像你说的那样。So with cross-chain payment, the current solution that you always need something like a switch. If you go to the bank, they always ask you to give a SWIFT code, right? What's the SWIFT code of the Toronto Bank? What's the SWIFT code of the Montreal Bank? So you need to know the code. After that, you pay them amount of money, right? For example, 1% transaction fee or 0.5%transmission fee, then the processing, and then your money will arrive, or your fund will arrive on the other side of the world. After one or two business days, they call it fast transmission, right? But with blockchain, there's so many gateways, right? With all the solutions, with traditional solution or classic solution, there are lots of gateways. So in Canada, there are 5 big acquirers. When you want to transfer your funds, so you have to pass one of the acquirers as well as you need to pass all the gateways. Each gateway has delay. Each acquirer, you're doing the KYC, you're doing this, you're doing that, you're doing lots of checks. At the end, when you reach to the other side, it takes a lot of time. But with blockchain, the Ripple solution, that was a solution called Ripple, which is the name of the coin, they call it the Ripple coin. But this Ripple is different from that Ripple. So, Ripple is a protocol to allow you cross-border transfer funds without less gateways, because even the fiat money, even the cryptocurrency, it can go through the same protocol. This is quite different. And this transaction happens within seconds. There are lots of banks in the world that already started research and doing this. As I know, even in China, there are some banks is starting accepting. But Ripple is from, different from Ripplecoin. Ripplecoin is a coin which is held by the Ripple library, but Ripple is a protocol. So that's different. Ripple is a protocol. Is a technology. 那么在跨境转账这方面，我们如今用的一些转账方式，它不但非常的费钱，而且它还比较慢。一般来说，如果一个电汇的话，你通常的结算时间会多达两天。那么如果你去银行的话，那么这时间的延迟是怎么造成的呢？是因为你这中间有很多的双方，有很多我们称之为的快结算方，中间也有很多很多的结算端口，你每过一次结算端口，你们就要过一次验证，那么这一步一步的过程，它都造成了很多的延迟。而实际上，当你使用了区块链的时候，因为这些结算在一个比较著名的例子就是 Ripple 的协议下面，你在过很多网关的时候，它其实一次性就过去了，因为它所有的地方验证和通过都是公开透明的。所以说，通过用 Ripple 来清算的方式，它会很快达到另外一端。这就是为什么摩根斯丹利、高盛一些银行，他们都已经开始接受 Ripple 的方式。这可能也是去年 Ripple Coin 大涨的一个原因，因为越来越多的组织和机构开始接受 Ripple 这种协议。Yeah, another interesting product we are using a lot is KYC. For people who have been investing in cryptocurrency before, or even open a bank, right? Or even in Canada, you rent a house.Open office, they always ask you to fill a form, right? Sometimes you feel very annoying. The major reason is that they don't want to fill this form. They ask you, what's your name, what's your salary, what's your birth date, where you come from, where I've been working the last 5 years, and then you have to take a photo, your selfie, and put it online. You say, why you need to do something so much forms, right? And each time you go to one place, you have a substance.And go to another page, submit it again. And all these organizations, those informations, they're not connected together. So you have to fill it again and again. And how about one of the organizations? They leak your message, leak your information. They open to the world. Anybody can take it and make a use of it. That's why there's a lot of ID fraud as well. But with blockchain solutions, you just need the one place. You have private key, public key. You show people the public one, and you just need the minimal information to show that, to prove that who you are. Right? That's the validation and the advantage to use this one for KYC. That saves lots of tons of paperwork. And then currently for KYC, usually it takes 1 to 30 days. Now why not using blockchain technology to eliminate this long progress, right? So this is one way people can use it. So IBM and Credit Multiple America, they already started working on this solution. And the anti-money laundering and anti-financing of terrorism, they can use this technology. It's quite interesting. 那么第二部分关于知晓你的客户的流程，通常在我们现在的时代是非常漫长。它一般要你们都有租房经历，或者是去银行开户经历，它通常就需要你很长很长的时间来过这个流程。它需要1到30天。但是如果在而且你会把你的资料分布在所有的机构组织里面。那么如果有一个机构组织把你的个人信息泄露了，你基本上等于在所有地方都泄露。 你永远不知道是谁盗用你的ID做了什么，包括我们每年都能在加拿大看到一些新闻说，有人的信用卡被盗用了，然后银行里莫名其妙的多出了一笔债务。那么如果当这些东西在区块链上的时候，你要证明自己，你只需要很少一些信息，你的私钥能保证你是谁，而你需要展开公开信息是非常少，任何人是没有办法轻松的来 access 你的这些数据，比如说，而且这些数据可以在机构之间得到共享，这就是什么？为什么区块链在 KYC 上面它可以减少大量的人力物力，减少很多的办公室的这些 paperwork 的重量，指定。So trade problem. So the trading is quite another interesting topic that the trading platform now is still based on paper. So you need to sign a form, say I bought this one, and you prove you buy it, and you go through lots of board, and the product you find arrive to a place. Think about you are shipping one product to China. You maybe have 50 people accessible data. So you have lots of people with accessing data, and you have to give them all the process, everything, the data needed, and this is time. So if you transfer it in the blockchain, it's the same. It's considered as KYC because you can easily validate where it comes from, where it goes, and all the place shows on the blockchain, and you cannot modify it. Because only people who have the privilege with a specific private key can change the status. You cannot easily change it just by writing a paper. So that's how it works with trading platform. 关于贸易这一块，我们其实也是一样的，就是说，当你一个产品从中国到加拿大的时候，你可能要通过超过50个人去读取这些数据，甚至有修改权限，这是一个非常繁杂的工作，而且并不安全。那么，当你用区块链的解决方案的时候，你只有谁控制了这些私钥的人，才可以改变这些状态，而查证并不需要私钥，你可以很容易验证这些商品的通关流程，这只是在交易平台上的一个应用。 So for insurance industries, you can see that this is one part from IBM. So before you have the claim process, they call it the P&C process. For people who is very familiar with insurance, you probably know that what is P&C. So you have a claim submission, you have a loss assessment, and you have the claim approval. All of them involve lots of people and lots of things, lots of paperwork. For each process, you have to pass the security auditing, keep everything in the safe place, KYC, everything. You can see that it's quite complicated. You don't even want to go to detail, right? So, 关于保险业，传统的保险业，当你去提交一个保险的申请的时候，你一般要过很多很多流程，从申请到 评估到最后的批准，它中间有超过20个步骤，这是非常繁杂，而且要很多人参与的工作。So in the future, all this one can be simplified by smart contract. You get approval, you get submission, and you get payment. go through the smart contract. People validated your process electronically from all those ones. If it's okay, if it's not okay, conditions, smart contract, auto transfer the funds to your account. It can greatly simplify the process. And all those things can be done by the cloud blockchain. And if you are lucky, maybe you can integrate it to our Nebula AI platform, which is the AI accelerated blockchain. And all the process maybe can accelerate by AI. And this AI now on top of the blockchain. So this can be one interesting scenario in the future in the finance in Nebula AI blockchain. So, 在未来的话，这些活动它其实都是可以通过区块链的智能合约来实现的。 那么它无论是你的申报流程，还是评估流程，还是最后的使用流程，它们都是可以用智能合约来完成打款。那么在这些评估的流程中间，你甚至可以用人工智能来驱动。那么在人工智能评估基础上完成支付的时候，你可以在区块链上达成。那么当这两个东西集合在一起的时候，你们可能就可以用到 Nebula AI 的技术，一个基于区块链的人工智能的平台，你们可以用人工智能完成任务。 通过区块链来集成，用区块链就行，来完成就行。So for business, like we have supply chain, healthcare, and real estate. 那么在商业方面，我们有供应链管理、医疗管理和房地产管理这三大块可以使用。那么，for supply chain, actually, it's more like you tracking the product, how it's made, to how to deliver to a customer. You have a state of change, so you go to the each who is shipping, who change doing the validation, who is consuming. So those activities can be locked on blockchain. 那么在供应链管理这一块，一个产品的从生产、销售到运达、客户最后被使用完毕、被谁消费的，所有的过程都可以在区块链完成。它保证了每一个状态不可更改、可溯源。 那么它在供应链上可以减少、节省很多的这些环节中的这些效率。那么有两家公司在做这些。So, let's go to the healthcare. Healthcare is also very important because everybody has care. There you have health insurance, this kind of that kind of thing. And all this data is very sensitive and should be kept in a safe place. We know that in Canada there are different regions, the information is not tied together. Because organizations have issues about connections and also trust. So this blockchain, only patient or also right party have the key can access this piece of data. Then make sure that your data is kept safe for yourself instead of other organizations. If you don't give me permission, nobody can access it. 那么在医疗行业也是一样的，因为我们在这里有很多的数据，这些数据其实都是非常敏感，数据推敏也是一件很难的事情。 但是在区块链上，因为只有你拥有这些私钥的人可以去拿到这些数据，你有权去授权谁来使用这些数据。那么这些数据拥有权是真正属于你的个人，而不是属于某个医疗机构。它可以在这方面加大我们的医疗的电子信息化过程。 Also about real estate. For real estate, lots of people, there's average person will move 12 times during the entire life. So the property transfers a lot. And who is the owner? Who has made some changes? And those information not all in paper in the national database, which is centralized. If you decentralize and make all the transfer transparent, some sales agent maybe lost their job. Because we don't need to keep the agent to prove that this one history is not be changed. All the data is on blockchain. Nobody can change it. So Switzerland is already start using the solution. 那在地产行业，同样我们也牵涉到这些信息改写的问题。瑞士国土统计局已经开始使用区块链来登记房产，来保证没有人能够轻易的改变它的状态。那么可能在未来，我们不再需要地产机构来给我们提供一份详细的报告，因为这些信息都是公开、统一可查的。Also for government. So government's ID management, tax, and funding usage. 那么在政府这一块 ，ID 的管理、税收和资金管理，access to one place, you should have all the access from different world, right? So it's very common sense to have those electric devices recorded on the ID management system. 在政府里面，这些 ID 的管理一直是非常重的 paperwork。那么我前一阵子遇到的问题就是说，各个信息在政府部门之间并不通畅。那么如果区块链的话，那么你很多信息其实都是公开透明的，就不需要那么的麻烦。在加拿大边境管理局，他们已经开始用区块链来进行通关的一些管理。So for tax purposes, then, so with lots of people was doing the human error and efficiency in that information, like if you have everything on the blockchain, it can accelerate the tax processing. 税务管理也是一样的，因为你有那么多的信息，你如果全部依赖于汇总到某一个地方，它是非常耗时耗精力的。但是如果你在链上记录了某些数据，因为这些数据你可以直接去从不同的地方，从不同的环节直接去拿到，又是无法人为作为或者是修改这些 POS 机器里面的数据的话，它会非常容易的去获得这些。Funny usage. So when governments give universities and industries lots of funds, people were asking where this fund has been going and how people use it. This blockchain, you can easily find the funds away from this address to that address. You can easily tracking who is using it and where it goes. And in Canada, the NSBRC, they already started publishing issuing funds through blockchain on Ethereum blockchain network. 那么在资金使用这一块，如果你使用区块链的话，你会非常容易去查证这些资金的流向。因为如果你们用过比特币或者以太币的区块链的话，你永远是从一个钱包流到另外一个钱包地址，那么这些钱包地址的流程就会标明资金使用方向，它是不可作为的。所以说，在加拿大自然科学基金委员会已经开始使用区块链来追踪这些资金的使用方向，有些政府的这些合同已经放到了以太链上面，那么你们可以上网去查证这些资金使用和使用。For other industries, it's major about cyber security, data storage, and something like artificial intelligence. 那么在其他行业应用还包括信息安全、数据的存储和人工智能方向。那么关于这些东西，我们会在接下来的几个话题中来详细的解释。Yeah. So, for all the information is introduction about blockchain. So it's a very condensed information for everyone.So if you have any questions, you can ask me, or we can talk about this with details after the conference. 因为这是一个比较简略的介绍，但是它的内容很多，所以如果你们对这里面的某一个话题特别感兴趣的话，我们可以在会议结束之后来单独去探讨某一个行业的具体应用。谢谢大家。
区块链啊，一共是这个政府、商业啊，以及我们的金融行业，还有其他企业这个四个方面的讲解我们金融行业。那大家啊，如果没有听够的话，不要着急 ，Charles 杜尔还会上来和我们讲解其他方面的这个话题啊，关于区块链和人工智能的。那我们现在呢，邀请我们 Lincoln 的 CMO Arthur Yan， 也就是他呢是加拿大顶尖商学院劳瑞尔商科毕业，曾就职于全球最大 online 汽车租贷公司，有着丰富的大型演讲、企业管理、人才招聘、商业扩展、市场营销的经验。那他今天呢给我们带来的话题是如何购买第一个您的比特币。Everyone welcome Sir CMO of Lincoln.The topic he's going to present is how to purchase your first Bitcoin easily with Lincoln Inc. Everyone, welcome.
All right, thank you for the introduction, and then thank you, Charles, for your presentation. We've learned a lot about all the basic knowledge about blockchain, and then all the industries we can use blockchain.To apply the blockchain technology to do that. So today I'm going to tell you a little bit about our product. It's called Lincoin.pro. So it is actually the best OTC platform that I think out there. So by starting this, I want to tell you a little bit about myself. My name is Arthur.So I am the CMO of Lincoin.pro and also I am a partner of YesBit Technology in the LTD. So I graduated from Wilfrid Laurier University a couple of years ago, and I took business program. So during my time at the university, I had lots of experience, especially for social media marketing, and especially for overseas content. So I was dealing with all the students overseas. And I was the only international student that was elected as the domestic recruiter to help the university to recruit students. So what that means was that when I graduated from university, I went on to over 100 high schools in Ontario, and then presenting Wilfrid Laurier University to all the high school students using their mother tongue, which is English, which is my second language. So that gave me lots of pressure, but also I had a lot of chance to, you know, practice my English. And after that, I went on to work for one of the biggest online car rental company. It is still one, the biggest one right now. And then during my work there, I had lots of experience with marketing as well. And then last year, my business partner, Bruce, who started the company YesBit, asked me to join him to start the whole thing together. So I am also a newbie to the space. So keep that in mind. So whenever, so afterwards, when you have you know, difficult questions to ask about the space, you can go ahead and then ask Charles about it, because he knows much more than I do. So that's a little bit about myself. And so this is the platform I want to tell you about. It's Linkcoin.pro. So it is a P2P platform. So what that means that is that you don't deal with money transactions like on the platform, whereas you actually deal with, it's a peer-to-peer, so you deal with each other individually. So everybody knows that if you want to invest in cryptocurrencies, the first thing you have to do is to use your fiat money to buy cryptocurrencies. So fiat money means your regular currency. It's like Chinese RMB, you know, Canadian dollars to buy those cryptocurrencies. But right now, the central banks is holding a lot of, they are putting a lot of restrictions on doing this. So it's very hard for people to actually use your let's say use your Canadian money to buy let's say Bitcoin on those exchanges directly. They have lots of restrictions, which is very, you know, in this space, because everybody says that like the in the cryptocurrency world, things change dramatically like every day. We have a Chinese saying, is it means means that, so if you stay in the space for one day, it means a year in the regular world. So that means how fast it changes. So that's not good for if you want to invest in Bitcoin, because the market changes so dramatically, and you still have to spend lots of time to, you know, update your ID information. You know, you have to transfer your money into the central banks, and then the other platforms, they have to wait to verify all the transactions. So during that time, the market could have changed so much, and then it's not the best time to buy Bitcoin anymore. So, and that needs to be changed like right now, because based on our research, there are over 20 million people in the world who is participating in the cryptocurrency space. So that's a lot of people, and actually that can support over 30 over-the-counter platforms. So that's why Linkcoin is here. So we're here to help you guys to take down the barriers between you and the cryptocurrencies. We want to make sure that it's so much easier for you to buy cryptocurrencies. So this, because like I said, there's no currency involved in on our website. So that's actually a very good thing. So because no fiat currency involved, and then there's no heavily, it's not heavily regulated, which give us a lot of potential to grow in the space. And also that's very convenient for both the users, you guys, as well as us, the owner of the website, because like you get paid directly. So if you want to sell a Bitcoin on the website, you get paid directly. You don't have to wait until, you know, 5 days to get the money transferred back to your bank account. And for us, it's good as well because we don't have to deal with all the regulations in the bank, which is so much easier for us. So you may be asking, are there any other OTC platforms out there? Yes, there is a bunch of them. However, like I said, there is only, so based on our research, we can support, the whole market can support about 30 OTC platforms. And right now there's not too many out there. So these three are the major ones, major players that we look up to. So we have local Bitcoin, we have OTC BTC, and then we have CoinCola. So among these four platforms, Linkcoin actually has a lot of advantage, as you can see from here. So first of all, we are one of the two OTC platforms that has our own token. So by having our own token actually give us a lot of advantage. First of all, we can share the growth with all the users. So as I think some of you have heard about Binance, one of the biggest exchange out there. Their token was, when they did their ICO, was $1, and then now worth is like 80 times more than that. So and also if you were to use the token, you can get discount on our website as well, because you have to pay transaction fee. And if you were to use our token, you get 50% off. So that's a huge discount for you. So that's that. And then in terms of the mobile apps, it's pretty popular. Among all the fours, only local Bitcoin doesn't have a mobile app. And next one is the most important one, is that we will be listing our coins on other exchanges. So you know how if you are an altcoin, you have to be able to get your coins traded with others to be able to have to increase the value. So for us, we will be listing our coins onto one of our partners in May right away, and then that has been confirmed already. So among all the fours, we are the only one doing that. So that will make a huge difference in terms of the price for our token. And then in terms of global currency, we are supporting not only Canadian dollars, but also Chinese dollars as well. And then we will be adding all the other major coins, all the other major currencies after. And then among the other ones, there's only local Bitcoin that is doing that. So like I said, so we have lots of competitive advantage over the other platforms. So this is our user interface. So right now we have, like I said, we have our web version, as well as we have the iOS app, as well as we have Android app. So there are different ways for you to use our product. So you guys are please feel free to go onto our website right now and then download our app, because after my presentation, I'll have my colleagues to come up here to tell you how to use our website. So feel free to do that right now. So how it actually works. So think Linkcoin as an eBay. So instead of selling goods, we are selling coins. So how it works that, for instance, so if you are a buyer, so you come to our website and you look for all the ads we have on the website, and then you choose the best price that you want to pay. And then let's say you want to spend $1,000 Canadian dollars on Bitcoin. So you just put 1,000 into 1,000 Canadian dollars, and then make an offer. And then after that, the system will receive that offer, and then we'll lock the other person, whoever is selling the Bitcoin, $1,000 worth of Bitcoin. So that we will be ensuring that they actually have this much Bitcoin to sell. And then after that, the seller will actually get notified by, they will be notified on their phone if they have our phone app, as well as on in their email as well. So when they get notified, they will come back to the website and then start to the whole trading process. And then by the same time, you as a buyer, you will be able to access, to have access to all of their payment information. So for instance, so right now we have Alipay, WeChat Pay, Bankwire, as well as indirect email transfer. So you'll have all the information on the website, so you can choose the one that you want to use and then pay the other person. And everything that I talked about payment is, it happens over the counter, so Linkcoin doesn't do anything about it. So you and the other person, you will be doing the transactions by yourselves. And then after the other person receives the money, they will come back to the website and then click a link. They call release the coin. So after that, you will be able to get the coin right away into your account. So this is how it works. And then like I said, my colleague will come upstairs and then introduce you a little bit afterwards, after my presentation. So because we are a exchange, although OTC exchange, we will be able to list different coins. Other than Bitcoin, Ether, Litecoin, you know, Bitcoin Cash, all the other ones, we will be listing altcoins as well. Altcoins are the ones, developed on base of like the Ethereum network. We'll be able to list their coins onto our website as well. So how are we gonna do that? There are two different ways we are gonna do this. So first of all, if you know a new, if someone had an ICO and then they want to have their tokens list on our website, all they have to do is send us a request. And then after we get this request, we have a team of experts. We'll go over everything about the coin to decide whether we want to have it listed on our website. If it passed all of our exams, it will be able to list on our platform. And then whoever sends the request will have some tokens or whatever as a bonus as well. So that can encourage everyone to submit different coins. So that's the first way of doing it. The other way is to do this similar to what Huobi did before. So we will be issuing a list of coins maybe every month or every quarter to send to all of our users. And all of our users will be able to use their LCT to vote for their favorite altcoins. And then any top ones will be able to list on our website automatically. So we did our ICO last month, and we started from March 13th, 14th, yeah, March 14th, and then we finished by the end of March. So it was a very short period of time. And we were able to raise over 10,000 ethers, although it's not as much as we were expecting, because our goal is a little bit more than that. But we think that we did a pretty good job, because if you take into the consideration of the market, the performance of the market, you would understand that it was a bear market. And then anyone that we encountered with on the road who was trying to raise money, it was really hard for them to raise money as well. So we think we did a very, very good job just by raising over 10,000 ethers. So where did the value of the token come from? So there are different points. So first of all, our token is a utility token. So you can use our token on our website. It's similar to Binance as their BNB token. So if you were to, and also it is a ERC-20 standard token. So it's based on the Ethereum network. So if you were to use the token on our website, because we have a transaction, you will be able to actually get 50% off on the transaction fee. So that's a huge benefit for all the ones who wants to trade on our website frequently, and they don't want to pay that much money. And that is actually being calculated based on the value of the token, on the market value. So that means, so let's say our token LCT will be listed by Bitbox in May, and then let's say in May the price of our token is $1. And then, for instance, if you did a transaction on our website, and then you need to pay $1 worth of transaction fee. If you were to use our token, all you have to pay is 0.5 LCT, because you get 50% off. And then let's say in June, our token value goes up to $10. Let's hope so. And then all you have to do is you pay 10% of what you paid before. So instead of pay 0.5 LCT, all you have to pay is 0.05 LCT. So it doesn't matter how much money your token worth, like you can still benefit from the increase of the token value. And also, so for all the coins that we have, you'll actually be using 50%, so half of our profit, to buy back all the tokens that we have out there. So this way, we will help to increase the value of the token, because as you learn from economics, as the supply goes down, the price goes up. And we will also have a protection fund that will be used to protect all of our transactions on the website. So let's say anything happens to our website, to our users, we'll be using those funds to give back to the users. And then in terms of international support, so we, although we are exchange, it's very easy for us to go to any other countries, because all we have to do is to list the payment information on our website. So for instance, we started in China, and then we have WeChat Pay and then Alipay. These are the two most popular payment methods in China. So we have that, and then just a couple of weeks ago, we added Interact e-transfer for Canadian dollars. All we did was spend less than one day, and then to have the user interface to add those to the user interface, and then that's it. That's all we need to do. So let's, for instance, if we were to go to Europe, all we have to do is to have a place on the website to list your PayPal account or your OKPay information. That way, you can start to trade the countries. Whoever lives in Europe can start to trade on our website. So this is the partner that I mentioned. It's called Bitbox. They are actually one of the better ones out there. There are over 200 exchanges out there, and then they are ranked about 19th. As I when I did my research, this gives us a huge benefit, because we'll be actually sharing all of their users with us. They have over 300,000 users on their website, and then whoever registered on their website will be able to trade. We'll be able to log on to our website automatically. You don't have to go on to our website to register for another account. You can use the same account. So that will drive that many people to our website. That will help our token, or help our website to develop a lot. And so that's our partner. And in terms of participating, so here is a list of all the profits that happened before. So for last year, for the other three big OTC platforms, they had just a little bit over $2 billion worth of trade volume. So that means $25 million transaction fee, as well as, oh sorry, that's for next year. So in 2018, we anticipate the market will be $5 billion. So that means $25 million transaction fee, as well as $10 million withdrawal fee. So now we have Link Coin. Our goal is to be as good as they are, or even better than them. So let's say in 2018, if we are able to, you know, do the same as they did, we will have $35 million revenue for our website. Or let's say if there's a worst case scenario happened, we only had 10% of their revenue. That's still $3.5 million revenue. So for a startup company, I think it's a very good amount already for 1 year. So this is what I mentioned before, to add different coins onto our system. So we already have Chinese yuan now, and then we just added Canadian dollars on our website. In May, we will be adding all the other ones, for instance, Korea dollars, Japanese dollars. My partner, Blues, actually went to South Korea in March, and then he's in Japan right now talking to business partners. So we'll be having lots of strategic partners add on to our website. And then as well as for the Euro, for British Pound, we'll be able to add them onto our website very fast as well. It probably will happen in May. So that's a little bit about our company, our product. And also I want to mention something about our company. We are actually hiring. So if anyone here is interested in blockchain, you want to learn more about blockchain, you have experience on operations, please feel free to talk to me afterwards, because we are hiring. Our team is expanding very fast right now, so please feel free to come talk to me. And then after this, so I want to invite my two colleagues to come upstairs to actually tell you guys how to use our website to buy your first ever Bitcoin, if you haven't done so. Actually, how many people here have Bitcoin or Ether? Can you raise your hand? Okay, so we still have a lot of people that will be interested in using our website, which is good. All right, so we have, this is Wayne, and then we have Richard here to show you guys.
Thank you, welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Hi, I'm Wayne, and this is Richard. We're developers at YesBit Company. Well, I will not talk about those very big numbers, but for myself, the scenario was like, I get into the crypto world at December, and I start to buy Bitcoin and Ethereum at, I think, 20K, right? At that price, and at that time, I want to use like a CoinSquare and a Coinbase, and I just think, wow, 20K is a really cheap price. And I start to go to these exchanges and put my money aside, but I think I wait at least one week. And then I have they have put my money in their exchange. But at that time, 1 week has passed and the money has already go up to 22K. So you can guess how sad that I am. Yeah, it's true. So in this website, you don't have such problem, because you are transfer money to the sellers, and then the money doesn't go through the exchange. That's why we think this is a good way, and this is the future way. This is the over the counter, because we don't touch any fiat money, and we don't have to set up a bank account in different countries, and. We just have this website, and everyone using our website, they can transfer money from peer to peer. Okay, let's start our presentation. I've already posted the advertisement here. The first one on top, which is me, I'm selling BIX token, which is BIX. So here, Richard is the buyer, I'm the seller. And then we're going to show you how we can buy token. In the future, we think we might accept more tokens like Civic or whatever. I'm just saying that. We may just accept more tokens. And now we're selling like Ethereum Bitcoin, Ethereum Classic, and Bitcoin Cash, and EIX. And we have already put Litecoin token online. So in the next two weeks, you're able to trade Litecoin token using our website. Okay, here. Oh, how about this thing? Yeah, as you can see, I've already posted my ads here, and this is the broadcast of Richard's mobile phone. Here, he will buy my advertising. Yeah, he has already clicked on it. How much do you want to buy? Okay, buy like $10, okay? Okay, $10. And here you can say you can buy 12 BBox token. Buy, click. Yeah. Then, in his mobile phone, he has already placed that order. And here, as you can see, the red point you see there is in the order, and you click on it. Yeah. Here, I will say that someone is going to buy my token. And here, I will click on this, and this is the chatting window. Actually, people type, but we can talk.
Yeah.
How do you want to pay?
WeChat.
Okay. Do you play Word of Rap? Why not? If you have a very famous equipment, you can trade that with me. Yeah, of course, people can trade anything. This is the amazing thing of the over-the-counter part. Okay. Okay, that's me.
Give me your money
now. Ah. Okay, the third one is me. Yeah, quick. Because one Canadian dollar is equal to 5 RMB.
Yeah, that's quick.
Okay, here, as you can see, I've already received the money. All I need to do is click and accept. Yeah, I've already received the money. So here, after we have done the offline transaction, I mean, this transaction doesn't go through Litecoin. It only go through me and Richard. And after both of us has made this transaction, and we both acknowledge this transaction, and then Litecoin as the exchange will release the token I have locked here. So. Yeah, Mark paid. Because he has already paid, and I have really received the money. Okay, it's international. Sorry about that. So once we click on the Mark Pay, and here I will also need to confirm this transaction that I have received the money. As we mentioned, if you have registered in BBox, and you can directly log into our website using the BBox account. You can do that.
Yeah. So he paid the money to you and you kept the money, but he was not responsible. Or like you said, I didn't get the money.
Okay. What happened in the... This is a very good question. And to make sure that this transaction is done, I have to lock my money into Inlinker coin. So in this way, that like I have once have locked the money inside. Oh, sorry. Before I post my ad, I need to have enough money in my account. Only then I can I post this ad. Okay, token money. And if I receive the money, but I pretend like I receive nothing, the consequence would be like the token was locked into this in the link coin. So it's not a good thing for both of us. And this platform has been running for in the test period for like at least 1 year, and we have only two cases that actually have this problem, that the buyer really sent the money, but the seller doesn't receive the money. So to solve this problem, we have a 5% of the, we have raised a lot of Ethereum, right? And we will have 5% of the Ethereum to solve such problems. If they can prove I really paid, and but somewhat I didn't receive the money, the Linker coin company will compensate such situations.
I need to add a little bit onto what Lee said there. So I guess for your question, you were wondering whether, so if you were to, if you paid the other person and then they don't go to the website and click, say like I received the coin, the money, right? Yeah. So in that way we have a different ways, like what he mentioned that we have, that's like the last few options we would have, is to have our own reserve of money to pay you. Actually, before that, we will be doing things like the buyer, you would have to, you know, to send us some provement that you have paid. So let's say if you paid in WeChat, all you have to do is to, you know, to screenshot what you have paid and then send that to us by email. And then most of the time, people will just go ahead and then pay, release the coin back to you. So during the time that we were testing everything, we didn't get any, I think only a few of those situations happened. So that, like usually when people buy on our website, there are not things like that happens. And also that we also have a rating system on our website. So if you, it's like, I don't know, there we have a lot of Chinese people here, everybody knows Taobao. So when you go to Taobao to buy stuff, you will see their rating system. You will see, you know, how many positive reviews do they have, or any how much negative reviews do they have. We actually have those systems as well. So you'll be before you do the exchange, the trade, you will be able to see how well this person's reputation is, whether you want to choose to trade with them. Most of the time, people want to keep, if they want to stay on the website for a longer time, they won't be risking their own reputation to do that. So we don't see that as a huge issue.
The point is, like, Taobao uses Alipay. Alipay can get the money first and hold the money, then release the item, right? But in your case, like, the buyer and the seller directly communication with, like, WeChat or the, like, Alipay, but that's through your exchange, right?
Okay, sorry.
Not token.
Yeah.
Not.
Sorry, we may, maybe I haven't explained this properly. So what we did on our website is that we locked the tokens. So when you start to issue an order, let's say you want to buy $10,000 worth of Bitcoin, that much Bitcoin will be locked on our website. So you actually have that much Bitcoin to sell before you can accept the transaction.
So that's one side. I mean, the Alipay have two sides, right? Monday and iPhone. You just lock the iPhone.
No, for Alipay, they won't be locking the goods. So if you are buying anything on Taobao, they can issue. So what happens on Taobao when they first came up? They can send you like a brick, right? Like they can't, the website, they cannot control your goods. All they can control is one side, is money. And then similar to what we did here, we control the goods, which is the tokens. We will be able to accept more questions afterwards. Please keep your questions for now, and then we can answer them after all the presentation is done.
Okay, thank you. Let's go back to the presentation. So, okay, Richard has confirmed that he has paid the money, and here what I have to do is just to click on the release tokens. Oh yeah, I need to input my password. Yeah. This transaction has been done. The buyers mark orders and the sellers release the tokens. And until now, the Richard can check his money in his mobile phone. Yeah. As can be seen here, the Richard has already, me and Richard have already finished this transaction. So this is the whole procedure of the Link Coin token. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask us before, after this meeting. Yeah, thank you.
刚刚我们讲解了这个虚拟货币交易平台是怎么样操作的，那也很感谢我们Rachel跟我们亲自演示了一下这个如何用微信和这个他们的网页进行这个交易。那现在呢，我们刚刚Charles给我们讲解了一下这个区块链在各行各业当中的运用，那他现在呢会给我们讲一下他自己的专业领域。区块链和这个人工智能如何结合？那他为我们带来的主题呢是整合人工智能的算力共享链。让我们欢迎 Charles 给我们带来的演讲。Let's welcome Charles to present a presentation between blockchain and AI.
This is the Nebula AI, a decentralized AI blockchain. So, first of all, us, we have been working on this project for over than 1 year. The Nebula AI blockchain actually is a decentralized AI blockchain, which is integrated with artificial intelligence and shared economics. So, with Nebula AI blockchain, there are developers who can be able to develop their decentralized applications on top of the chain. And then we provide the API and the SDK which can integrate all those services with the chain service. Also, the payment part allows the developers to get the payments through those applications as well. The one of the most interesting things that we use the existing GPU mining rigs to do AI computing. So that enable the people who is currently mining with Ethereum, and in the future, one day, when Ethereum becomes proof of stake, so cannot be able to mine anymore. We can do with this mining rigs. Now we can use it for AI computing. 跟网上一样，中双 我们先介绍一下关于 Nebula AI 这一块。 Nebula AI 的话，它简单的说就是应用区块链的技术，把人工智能计算引擎搭载到区块链上面。这样的话呢，研发人员可以很容易的在区块链上开发他们的人工智能应用，并且呢可以在上面使用区块链来加速他们的这些人工智能的训练目标。同时我们还可以让服务区块链和人工智能的人获得一定的收益。我们最有趣的一个特性就是我们可以通过重用现在已有的 GPU 的挖矿硬件来提供人工智能计算。 OK, so there are an existing challenge in the AI computing. So for, I was being in Silicon Valley last month. For most people there, actually they are using Amazon cloud service for AI computing. The price for the minimum instance, the P2 instance is about 0.9 dollars, and it turns out that it's almost the only solution of using Google TensorFlow as well, Google Cloud Computing as well. So, but that's not the case because it's always very expensive. Secondary, like hash calculation, lots of people was challenging it. With Bitcoin, every 10 minutes you get 25.points, and with Ethereum every 10 minutes you get some points. Regardless of how many machines you have, you only get a dedicated amount of coins. Do we really need millions of machines doing the same calculation just for generating the blocks? So that's another challenge about the blockchain itself. But if we want to migrate all the data to do computing or AR on top of the blockchain,we have some concerns about data privacy. So this needs to be solved, otherwise nobody wants to use it. And for current cloud computing or AI computing, everything is centralized. Centralized have lots of disadvantages, right? So we rely on Google. We rely on Amazon because they are big company. They won't fraud us, so we save our data there. But do you know that, how about Apple?Apple is a big company, right? We trust them as well. But do you know that iCloud is not in North America anymore? They moved to China. Do you know that Facebook, they just sell about 50 million records, or maybe 17 million records. Just some party they don't know who play with your money, right? That is something you want to do. This is the problem of the centralization. So we need to solve all this problem.在目前而言，我们在做无论是人工智能计算还是云计算的时候，我们有很多问题。你最常用的 AI 云 Amazon 的云来为例，它的一个 P2 的一个实力一般要消耗0.9美元一小时，这是非常昂贵的一项消耗。我在加州的时候，我看到几乎所有的中小型企业都在用他们的解决方案，但我在中国旅行的时候，我看到所有人在科研机构在讨论问题，就是都是说，我昨天买了10张显卡，我要用它做人工智能计算，或者是我买了3张显卡，我要做人工计算。那问题在于，大家都在买这些显卡，而与此同时，以太坊这些数字货币的链却在用庞大的上百万的机器在做着同一种哈士运算，而所做的是做了一件事情，把这些数据写进区块链。那么用10台机器、100台机器和100万的机器到底有区别吗？可能在安全上有区别，但从本质上讲，你用10000台机器和100万台机器来做计算、做记录，没有问题。那么，关于数据安全也是一个问题。我们现在很多的数据都是存在中央的数据里面，比如说在谷歌的云里面，比如说在亚马逊的云里面。我们因为相信亚马逊，我们相信谷歌不作恶，所以说我们相信它。那么 Facebook 呢？我们相信 Facebook， 但是他们把7000万的数据卖给了不是盟友，不知道哪里的人去了。那么你又如何相信你是安全的？如果 Facebook 都不能相信，你就相信你的数据在 Amazon 上也是安全的？所以这些都是我们目前要解决的一些问题。 So our strategy. So our strategy is like, it's very easy. So we want to reduce the cost of computing from 0.9 to 0.2. 70% decrease. How to achieve that? We can use the Ethereum mining rate or other equal high GPU mining rates, converting it to GPU mining units. And we can share AI computing platforms. For example, if you have a high performance mining rate or AI computing as your technology worker, you may have 3 1080 AI cards for AI computing. How about share it when you are not using it? Let me use your card and pay you money, right? Does it make sense? I think people have been using Uber or Airbnb, right? But however, I'm going to say we're even better than that. Because as Uber and Airbnb, they still have a company called Uber and Airbnb. But this maybe AI is different. We don't charge you guys from the smart contract. The each payment you need is from the provider to consumer directly. So you don't need to worry about that. Who is taking my money? The people who is working for you. But if it's Uber or Airbnb, they take 30% from each transaction you make. That's lots of money. They use it for what? For the next building, for their employees, for whatever they do. But with blockchain, you pay for people who is directly. That's why the cost is so low than compared to Google and Amazon, because there's no profit, there's only work. The decentralized AI applications make sure the instance is running that somewhere you don't know. The anonymous people working for you and the data protection for sure will be implemented. So you don't even worry about who is accessing data, because this machine is randomly selected doing the task for you, and it will destroy the task from the disk and you never take it. In order to access those infrastructure and everything, we build our own AI training center. We have a training office in Montreal, Science January. We train the engineers to be an AI engineer as well as blockchain engineer to accelerate all the progress of development. 我们的解决方案是如下，我们将会把进行 AI 计算的消耗在同等性能情况下从90美分降低到20美分。我们如何做到这一点呢？因为我们通过共享人工智能计算工具和人工智能的把 GPU 转换人工智能设备，减少了中间绝大部分的消耗。而且因为我们没有那么多的员工在区块链上，区块链是一个社区共治的集体，大家为它来工作，但是当合约发生的时候，你只付钱给那些为你工作的人，这里面没有房租开销，也没有员工工资，这些都不存在。所以说在这一点上，即使 Amazon Google 他们想进行同样的服务，他们所需要的第一件事情是把他们的 building 拆掉，把他们的员工遣散掉，这样他才能把 cost 降低到跟我们一样处。那么同样的，作为数据，我们因为是用的是去中心化的存储方式，你们的这些计算任务和你们这些计算模型都会随机的分配到某一个计算的实力上面。当任务完成之后，这些实力会全部被销毁，没有人能够去获取你在计算过程中和计算之后剩余的数据，来确保你的数据的安全没有被某一个中心化的组织拿去利用。我们同样在蒙特利尔已经建立了我们的人工智能的训练学校，来训练大量的人工智能工程师为这个项目和整个人工智能的经济体而工作。 So this is the architecture about the Nebula AI blockchain. SoAt the bottom is the Nebula AI blockchain infrastructure. Everything is built on top of it. There are two groups of applications that will be built on top of that. The first group is the applications built by Nebula AI Foundation. We have two major research which is ongoing. One is we call Quantum AI, which is using to predict the property currency chain as well as stock market and futures. Also, we have other technology which is focused on biomedical engineering, which we just launched it 1 month ago with Professor Thomas Fence in Concordia, who has the entire biomedical engineering department involved with the Canada government and Metex program. Another kind of application people can build by themselves, which we call third-party applications. Those parts will be focused on genomics, algorithm, some protein sequence, or whatever AI computing they want to do. What they did is that they extract all the calculation and the computing capability from the blockchain, training the task, we call it DAI apps, decentralized AI application, and they provide those values to the consumers. The consumers who use those applications will pay the developer. Imagine that you are using the apps from the Apple Store. You pay the developers, developer pays the service to AI, to the Apple platform. So if you change the Apple to AI, it will be, you pay the developers, developers pay the cost to Nebula AI blockchain. Then, who gets the payment from the developer? This is the contributors, we call it. Contributors or miners. You're doing the task for them, you get paid. So it's very clear that developers build application, customers pay for the application, developers pay for the infrastructure to get the service over the auto chain. Okay. 在我们经济里其实是非常简单的经济模型。 Nebula AI 建立到了底层的区块链，在区块链上，我们分成两大组应用，一组是 Nebula AI 自己的应用，就些应用，主要是在金融预测和生物学工程学方向，因为我本科就是生物学工程学。然后呢，第三方还有第三方应用也可以接入，当他们接入我们应用的时候，他们可以在上面抽取整个人工智能计算网络的计算能力，为他们的计算来服务，而他们所需要只是支付一部分的计算费。 这些希望费用会优，现在我们称之为矿工，在未来我们会称之为他们的算力提供者来提供这些。那么他们的应用开发出来之后呢，这些去中心化应用将有很多的使用者。这些使用者会是谁呢？比如说我们预测行情的软件可能会是一些基金公司之类的。那么像这些生物学工程应用可能是一些潜在的一些疾病的患者，像。 以一种比较简单、迅速的方式，并且能够保护他们的隐私的方式来检查一下自己的疾病，那么他们是可以用这些平台来完成他们需要的这些服务。那么他们支付的费用部分是交给了研发人员，而研发人员会使用它来改进自己的计算网络和驱动更大的计算能力来为他们计算。你们可以想象，当拥有这样的一个计算网络，但这个计算网遍布全球的时候，只要你。 缴纳足够的资金，你甚至可能驱动全球的人工智能计算机为你服务。那么，比起 Amazon、 Google 在某几个地点设立几个数据中心，你觉得哪个是更加强大的？So this is the use case I've just been talking about, the AI quantum training. So it's about it's quite straightforward. It's enable you. To predict the Ethereum price. Later on, I will give you a short demo about how it works. And it will also show how it's running on the testnet. Our Nebula AI testing night has been online since January. So it's already working on it. So we can show some demos after, afterwards. This is the format about the quantum trading. You have a user panel on the right. So that's where the developers are accessing. And you get also data with big data processing, which is gather all the information and loading to your AI unit, for the AI processing unit. On the AI unit, it will add the sentiment analysis about how people feel about today's stock or price change. And we add it on top of the training algorithm, which will talk about how the changes about it, because when a lot of people were thinking that this price is going to increase, when you add it on top of the pattern can give you more accurate predictions. After that, it will trigger an automatically processing auto trading system. This streaming is where you place your order. It can be centralized, it can be decentralized, because this is your money. You do whatever you want. So this is the entire map about the development of the AI quantum tree. So, 这个系统它的作用是什么呢？就是当你作为一个用户来进入这个程序的时候，首先你会在一个用户面板面前去启动一个人工智能预测计算，那么它会首先从各所有的社交媒体上去抓取所有的信息，用大数据的手段来进行一些整理分类，根据你们的这些情感的变化，比如说我高兴我不高兴，我觉得这个比太要涨，比特要跌， whatever 你的想法，它会把你的想法转成一种量化的数据，加载在我们通常的人工机器人的预测模型上。通常用的是根据波动率分析，我们可能会按照这个模式，以前曾经发生过的模式，那么在现在模式它的走向可能是这样，当我们把两个模型叠加在一起的时候，它就能给出一个更加精确的预测。那么当这些预测做一些辅助工具产生的时候，你可以根据这个系统进行一个下单活动。那么这就是一个量化交易的人工智能量化交易的一个基本原理。The final graph, it looks like. They'll give you two curves. One is the actual curve, how it works. Another one is the prediction curve. So sometimes it works together, sometimes it doesn't work together. Usually, like in our custom, we're trying to do a prediction about 30 minutes to show how it works, what it will be like in the next 30 minutes, price change. 这个一个使用的一个用户体验图里面，它会有两条曲线，一个曲线是目前的行情状态，一个是我们预测行情状态。预测行情状态可能一般来说它会显示在未来的30分钟之内的走向，你到时候可以看到它到底跟现实的状况以后有多大区别。 So sentiment analysis can be also accelerated by theAI computing. So there are lots of data was processing currently with the sentiment to take account how people are feeling. Those data will be quite interesting because people can use it to do lots of purpose. One of them can be shows that, you know, like about the price changing in the stock market. Another one is people can use it to control your home. Sometimes you feel happy or feel not happy. Your mode of your sentiment can.Change the room or play the different music according to your feeling. So this kind of analysis will be done and through the AI engine. It requires lots of data, languages, using natural language processing. Those are time-consuming jobs which needs lots of AI resources. This part can use the AI calculation resource from the network and do the training. And you can probably accelerate from 3 months to 3 days or 3 minutes, depends on how much you pay. So, 那么在这些情感分析一个比较应用场景，就是说，当你高兴或者不高兴的时候，当你让你的智能家居设备的时候，它可能会根据你的语义或者你的心情来改变你的一些设置。那么这些感情也好，这些语义分析也好，它通常需要大量的数据，包括有世界各国语言、各种口音 ，whatever 这些东西的培训练的话，它需要。大量数据集它可能需要很多计算能力，如果你用普通计算机一张两张显卡来计算，你可能需要好几个月，但是如果你加了这样的平台上的话，你的这些训练会变得立即可用，它完全取决于你同时驱动了多少计算资源而已。而且你可以想象，你如果是驱动同样多数量计算机和慢慢计算，其实不会有本质的区别，这样只不过你能调动计算资源变得更加多。Okay, so this is our target customer. Usually one of the biggest customer will be this institution. That's why we are very active working with universities in China and Canada or North America, which is good places, because this will be one major group. That's why lots of people are asking us, what are you guys doing? We didn't show you lots of blockchain conference, because that's not our target market. Our target market is in research centers and individual customers. Who is can use those stories. Showing the blockchain conference just shows that we are doing blockchain business. But that's where the real business will be done. 我们现在主要一些客户是一些科研机构和个人用户。个人机构是我们的主要目标，因为只有他们在消耗大量计算能力。在我在很多地方访谈的时候，他们都在表示他们非常愿意去使用这些人工智能计算资源，因为他们有很多学生之类的。如果他们每个人都去用人工智能的话，那么可能教师就没有资源去用了。所以人工智能资源其实现在是一个非常紧缺的资源。So this is another example of biomedical engineering. So you have IPFS who distributed the data set, and you can do the RNA and DNA processing distributed on different miners to do the training and the testing. After that, you have different models training result and aggregate to one big result and send it back to the system. So this is one way to accelerate the different data processing and the aggregate together.在生物医学工程上面，因为蛋白质和 DNA 的计算通常是非常消耗计算能力的，你可以把这些计算全部拆分成不同的计算肉，在不同的这些训练集里面进行训练完成或者是计算完成之后，你再把这些计算结果全部的合成，再合成到这。那么这些工作之前其实已经有人在做过，并不是一个特别新的东西。之前的话，在 World Grid Computing 就计算过这些任务。但是为什么 World Grid Computing 一直没有大规模的发展？一个重要原因，他们缺了一个重要的物化 payment system。因为你为他们做了计算，但是并没有为计算付钱，你只是获得一个计算，而计算又不能换钱。但是如果你用这套系统的话，那么这时候你可以解决。我们通过 Nebula AI 的 token， 你为我计算，我为你付费，是非常简单的东西。So this is the economic cycle of Nebula AI coin.Can see that the Nebula AI blockchain is in the central place, and the users will buy the token from miners who provide the hash calculation, and the miners get contributed to the network. Developers pay the tokens to get the hash power. At the same time, users need to buy the service from the developer. So.在雷威 AI 的这个经济体里面，它的运营模式是非常明晰的。雷威 AI 提供了一个底层的区块链建设，程序员的程序会从用户那里收到他们的 token， 而用户将需要从计算能力提供者那里去购买 token， 而 miner 也就是计算能力提供者，他可以从 developer 那边去收取 token， 这样就完成一个循环经济体。所以在 Nebula AI 的经济体系里面，它并不需要增发大量的 token， 因为它可以完成自己的一个相应的自己的一个经济体的循环。It is some like evaluation from our Telegram and other groups. People are really interested about our progress, and they give us very high comments about it's a game-changing platform. 在我们的社群里面。包括今天到场的很多人其实都是我们社群的一部分，他们对我们的项目的评价是非常高的，他们认为我们正在改造整个 Proof of Work 这种工作量证明的区块链一种工作模式，把它从一个单纯的哈希计算变成了一个人工智能运算，有人说它是一个把一个以盈利为目的的项目变成具有社会意义的项目。So this is some user feedback about our prediction. We're doing screenshots several days ago. One guy was using our system to do prediction and compared it with the Binance exchange about Ethereum price. It seems like it's not good at that time. That's okay. We don't care about the trend. We care about our system accuracy. 这是在三月七号一张截图，当时。有我们的用户在看了我们的 demo 之后，他自己上去做了一个试验，并且把截图发到了 blockchain 的我们的 Telegram 的 group 里面。他对结果表示非常的惊奇，因为他居然真的跟实际在币安上面的走势一致，也许他们很 lucky。Thank you everyone for the presentation. We have small demo.Like the thing is working or it's just something still in progress.
Yes, you can. I'm a bit curious because you didn't mention if some of the GPU miner can be dishonest. I mean, the mining process can consume a lot of power, but what happens if one or two dishonest miners submit just a random result for your he might didn't train the module after all.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So we have a two-stage system. If you read our white paper, we have Helix and Ori. Helix is some simple contract. You need a job to do the validation. So one way that's the validation is using some simple data to validate the working or not working. Smart contract has payment in two parts, down payment and the final payment. So if you throw a system, get a down payment, cannot get the final payment. That's one thing with the design of Helix. But with Ori, we have total change. With the Ori system, we call it the proof of group, which has a ledger where many group of workers. Here we are in charge of the billing system. And in that system, you also have credits. So if you submit a project, and the credits is really low, and you don't do the job well, you will be deduct. And if you want to ask people to do a job for you, the same thing as the Ink Coin does. You have to send some amount of credit was deposited there. If you don't have that one, maybe your job will never be, you will never get the submitted job. Okay.
Sorry, one question.
Yeah?
Yeah. So, could you explain more how it could replace the proof of work? Because I'm very interested in this. It's really a game changer, yeah.
Yeah, the proof of work is like doing lots of hash at the same time, right? So with the Ori system, we're still talking about Ori, the proof of group is that you have a group of workers together, but there's only one ledger working for the billing, working the ledger work, which is very similar to the DPFT. Yeah, DPFT, yes. So which means that you only have one for that, and all the other workers was working for by managing by smart contracts. You get a payment by contracts. So whatever, how many ledgers working, you from our payment system, that only 2% of coins is generated by ledger. So it doesn't make sense for you to contribute a lot, only focus on mining. You should convert as many as your workers to computing, because computing is much more profitable than mining. Yeah. So we make sure the ledger amount is much less than what the current mining, but you cannot make too less ledger, too less group, or too small group. You cannot do too big group, because when the group is too big, maybe your task cannot fully distribute it. You're wasting some resource. So that's something like, so we have precautions for that to manage the group, how big it is, how small it is, so the dynamic change way. Okay, so I'll play the game. What's the management also? I need my data plan. Tasks inside. They get the task, there was no processing. 那么这个就是我们 的一个系统。当你想生成一个预测任务，你首先要付一定数量的 Nebula AI 的代币来支持它的工作。当你这个 coin 支付了之后，它就会生成一个 transaction， 会提交到任务池里面。那么这些工作机器就会在任务池里面去查看是否有任务生成。当任务生成之后，它会提交到链上。你可以看到这里面是有链的结数据的。我待会儿看，我先把它打开。那么你可以在上面去看查看这区块信息和这些智能合约。然后当有工作机来愿意接受任务之后，它会出现一行叫 task has been started。When there was a task was accepted by one of the working machine or working for the worker, that shows that task has been started. It takes time to process the data, as you see that the AI training is time consuming. That's why we need this platform. 那么当任务训练开始的时候，它会消耗一定的时间，因为人工智能计算通常是比较耗时的。这也是为什么我们一定要用GPU 来加速计算，而不是用你个人的电脑。因为如果你用个人电脑的话，可能用 GPU 算30分钟工作，你可能需要算3300分钟。那么正是因为如此，所以说当我们这个运行的时候，它可能会消耗一定的时间。好，预测结果结束了。我们可以看到，我们已经在预测结束之后，它会画出一张图来。这上面的实现部分是我们目前的以太的价格，那么后面的价格是我们的预测，它可能会在这个区间摆动。那么目前我们只做到30分钟，这是一个公众的模型，在我们内部实验室里面还有更加精确的模型。我们的 release 周期一般是2周左右。So we have this is the final graph about the prediction about the Ethereum price. Can see that the kind of positive.At the moment. So the blue line is the existing price and the red line is the prediction price. So we only predict 30 minutes at the moment and we have a release cycle about every 2 months. We already we have more accurate model in our internal lab which is not released yet. As you know, right? This business product. So yeah. And then you can also check your history. So, prediction history here, our task you have done before. 你同样可以去查看你在历史上所做的一些预测，因为你的数据全部都记录在区块链上面。在区块上，他们有你之前生成的所有的区块，你的智能合约和你的地址。Yeah, that's pretty much about the demo. Yeah. 这个就是我们做的一个小的应用程序，来展示人工智能计算。是如何跟区块链相结合，达到一个未来可能的实际应用场景？再说一
遍。Charles, question. First, thanks for the presentation. It's very informative. I was wondering. My first question is, what is the impact to the intellectual property?And how would intellectual property be protected, like in this application?
Yeah, that's a very good question. That's one big concern about if we submit both the data and the model, how people can protect the data and the model. So there's a couple of ways we are doing research now is that you can split the data, you can split the distributed task on different many bits. And the third one is that you need encryption about the data and the models.One way we can do that, when people access, find X data, whatever the person data, the data will be self-destroyed. To make sure whenever anybody who can touch it, sustain it, it just becomes no use. For sure, there are other ways to protect it. You have encryption on both sides, on the target machine side, on your sender side, that's something like we are working on.
So eventually, the contributor to the work will not have the access to the work itself after it was done, right?
Yeah, exactly. The work is done, it can be processed by the contributor as a human or external terminals. If you want to access it, it will be self-destroyed. So if you do that, as we mentioned earlier in the orange system, because the country asks you to have your credit deposit, you may lose your credits as well.
Okay. And my second question is, in about one decade, or just slightly more than a decade, Facebook, Amazon, Google had encountered one of the bottlenecks that you described in your presentation, that their hash power calculation power is no longer meeting the requirements in the market. For your industry as for now, it's still transforming, it's still like in its birthing state. What do you think about like in less than one decade, what your crisis or risk will be?
So, the biggest competitors, if we can consider it as competitors, is different blockchain. It's not a, there won't be a war between blockchain and companies. Companies cannot compete with blockchain organizations. That's why we always call, you can say all the blockchains, they have foundations. Because foundation, which means community work together, share economy, we contribute together. So if you have competitors, it's another blockchain institution. So only blockchain company can defeat blockchain company. There won't be a war with blockchain company and a traditional company. That's not the case.
But GE never had imagined. Sorry.
So sorry, we have time limited. So can you ask us a question after all the speakers finish?
Okay.
Thanks. Okay. Thank you. So because of the time limit, we have only 2 hours left. So but we still have like 2 more speech to go on. So let's finish the speech first and then go on the questions. And if we still don't have enough time, our speaker will be there, and you guys can ask them like privately. Okay. Okay. Thank you, Charles.
Thank you. Bye.
我们也试了一下它这个系统的整个一套模式啊，以及它是怎么样操作的这个系统啊。那我想请大家呢都有一个大概的了解。那我们下面呢，我们看到弹屏幕上已经有我们下面题目的一个题目出来了。那我们呢要有请到了吴航为我们讲解一下，因为大家都知道从比特币开始，所有的人都在开始关注这个区块链，那越来越多人好奇的区块链的走势到底怎么样。在未来的它到底能成长成一个什么样的模式？那我们今天呢很荣幸的邀请到了吴航，吴航呢他是90后技术背景资深区块链专家，前多伦多大学HR实验室管理及首席算法工程师，超人主义领头人，中科院青年合作项目伙伴，MIT BN Lab 智联组，曾对以太币技术的推广和解说做出贡献。 现阶段呢，致力于解决 ICO 出现的弊端和防止假冒电子货币产生的基于，ICO Research 上进行的研究。那么，下面有请吴航为我们带来的未来10年科技和区块链的商业融合。 So let's welcome our next speaker, Wu Hang. The topic he's going to present is how to combine innovative technology with blockchain. Okay, everyone, welcome.
The last person is actually asked because I can answer your question about the 10 years. First of all, the Bitcoin price, if you ask about any token price for the next 10 years, the answer is unpredictable. That's always the answer. That's the correct answer. And if you are asking what the technology would be, that would be a different answer. Okay? Okay. So, first of all, who am I? Because she forgets to say it in English. My name is Hang Wu, and I come from University of Toronto, HI Lab. HI stands for Humanistic Intelligence. And this lab, we're doing cutting edge, well, we're doing beyond cutting edge technology to fuse with these technologies together to create the next generations of technology that can actually benefit for the next 10 years or 20 years. Our purpose, since the lab is actually governed by one person we call Professor Steve Mann, they also known as the father of wearable computing. But what that really means is that he literally invented the prototype before the Google Glass that Google actually made. And also he's the inventor of HDR that's using in every single camera of yours. And he is also the inventor of, he has been done mobile technology since the 1990s. He has more than hundreds of researchers. He's one of the most well-known professors, researchers, and engineers in Silicon Valley, and the companies such as Google, Intel, hold him as the highest regard, and hold our lab in the highest regard. That's the thing you need to know. And second, what you need to know is a story. Because in a way, now I know that actually we are one of the potential customers of Nebula AI in the future that we would want to test it on. Because we always strive to use newer technology to create a world-changing product. And because of that, the story that I'm going to tell is that one of the world-changing startups that actually comes from our lab that receives the highest funding from Toronto, the highest funding in Canada. And he is actually competing with this is the person. This is his TEDx speech, and this person is my lab mate. He's a senior lab mate, but he is one of the smartest people in the world. Obviously, the only reason to know that is that his company is actually receiving the highest funding in Canada, and that's a seed round. He gets 20 million in seed, and his company is competing with Elon Musk on Hyperloop. What exactly is Hyperloop? Hyperloop is a technology that Elon Musk actually invented in 2015 to make the fastest train in the world. That's what exactly it is. Now, since that he actually invented this, I'm in order to compete with him, he actually asked me a question. He asked me, okay, Tom, here's the deal. I invented this, but how do I actually add blockchain into this? And he gave me like 30 seconds to actually think about it. But since that, I also have some kind of history, so I did answer it. This is actually me on actually wearing another startup's device that's also come from our lab. This is a brain computer interface. And brain computer interface is another newer technology to connect your brain to the computer. That's what it really is. So I do have a history. What my history is that I come from there. I do have a biomedical and a business background as well as electrical and computer engineer. And I have helped contribute a little on Elon Musk, another ambitious project, Neuralink, and also have done some volunteer work for the MIT Media Lab as well. So what we have done is that we try to combine a technology that's actually in the rising, that's actually constantly changing. That's most of the people don't really even know. And we try to transform it with blockchain again. And the reason we want to do that is because one thing, synergy. The technology, the combination of technology always created some kind of synergy. Because regularly, technologies are not just technology. What they really are is more like a puzzle. They are the puzzle pieces that you actually put together. And the way that you put it together can actually form a new product that worth way more money than what you originally seen. This is the key. The key of every single product, using every single new technology that you don't really know or understand, is really just because we want to create synergy to add more values. Add a double, triple, even 100 times more values to the technology. This is the reason why internet in 1998 or in 1994 is already extraordinarily popular in Silicon Valley. And it's only caught up in 1997 to China. This is the primary reason because only in 1997, China started to realize that the valuation of the internet, and even so, is only one or two or three people that come from China actually capitalize on it. That's the reason why it's actually extremely important to capitalize on not just one technology, but multiple technology together. As you can see that if you think about Nebula AI, for example, it's actually combining and try to fuse it together, AI and the blockchain, not as one piece, not as like two separated pieces, but actually as one piece, to actually fuse them together. And the reason why you want to do that is because that creates kind of synergy that actually makes more values. And the values is exactly what you need when you actually do this type of things. And in order to do so, and say if I have a project that I cannot even reasonably understand, and it doesn't really have enough resources or files to actually look on the internet too, then when you try to combine that with, if I can even combine that with blockchain, this means that you can literally combine any kind of, whether it's traditional businesses or is actually current technologies, you can combine them with blockchain. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay. 因为我刚才的话说的那些东西我并没有说到中文，所以的话我会拿中文的话再简单的重复一遍我刚才说的东西。我来自的话是多伦多大学HI实验室，我们以前所做过的东西的话永远是在做让世界改变的项目，这是一直以来我们在做的事情。所以的话我们的合作对象的话一直以来还有几个，一个是 MIT Media Lab， 其实一滴有并不算完全的合作，然后另外一个的话是 Stanford， 还有好像有啥事，我不记得。OK， 我们主要的合作对象和合作的方式是以不同的方式的话，将新的科技的话融合到一起，然后创造出更大的价值。而我相信的话，如果你能将新的科技的话，我能将一个完全我其实无法完全理解的一个新型的科技和区块链融合在一起的话，那么的话，所有的现在的认为的传统行业，因为这也是我一直得到的一个问题，就是如何将各种各样的行业的话与区块链合在一起，但我想向你证明的话是，如果的话可以把最新型的科技的话都能和它融合在一起的话，那么其他的科技的融合是必然会完成的。我是想给大家展示这个点。问题的话是在于怎么完成，而不在于能否完成。能否完成这个点的话，已经被证实了是完全100%可行的。We're going to call this. This is a transport. Transport is actually from my mind.Wow, the lab is from our lab. So this technology, since it's competing with Elon Musk, I have no idea exactly how the physics works. It's a real contextual product. It's not a software. You cannot just distribute it as tokens. This is not a software. This is not an algorithm. This is not some kind of code or some kind of a graph that you can justprotected. And sure, it does have patents, it does sure have IP, but there's no guarantee whether this IP can actually be corrected as well, can be, well, protected as well. 大家都知道是这里的所有的东西，这里的所有上面显示的东西吧，它是一个实体实物存在的东西，它现在连做都没有做出来，但是吧，最关键的问题是它没有足够的 IP 还有 patents 的话可以让你能保护它。所以的话，你不能用这样，它不是一个软件，所以你不能直接把它变成一群的货币或者 token。那如果在这种情况下的话，你到底应该怎么办？ Well, it comes back to what exactly is blockchain. Blockchain in its very core is a value transition system. It transits values. It's really like this train, though. It is a transit value from one place to another.That's exactly what it is. That's what it really is about. If you can actually capture the transition part, that's the key. If you can capture the transition part, you can capture exactly what the blockchain is, and you can actually connect technology or newer technology with the blockchain. 我想说的话就是这个东西的核心是价值传输，而价值传输的话就像汽车跑步一样的话，价值传输就是区块链的本质。而如果你能将价值传输这个点完美的显现出来，那么你的产品、你的技术就会是最好的区块链技术，这是100%正确的。So, I did that in 30 seconds, and I did increase the fair values by 50%. And the reason I believe is that we have a blockchain, which we have a startup that's actually extremely conceptual, is non-existent, it hasn't been existent, implemented yet, and it has a certain uncertainty. And that's also the original model of most of the technology when it first came out. Amazon, Alibaba, or Google. They all have similar faith. They have a certain uncertainty in their technologies and in their abilities. But one thing for sure is that they transit some kind of values. If they can actualize those values, then the people who invest in those values, they can benefit or profit from it. So in its core, blockchain can actually be the perfect investment system. In its core, it's always been the perfect investment system for technology. And that's what it is. It provides certainty and valuation. So any single technology that with blockchain, if it doesn't have some sort of valuation and some kind of provide some kind of a certainty, not just reliableness, not just trust, but certainty, then this can actually be done. So I propose a model that is actually using the transit ideas that actually store values from this conceptual idea, this conceptual design to the chain, and using that to provide a certainty that once this project becomes semi-successful, then every single investor can actually provide our values. If I can ever do that, then this chain can actually be connected to this very technology. And that's exactly what I did. I segmented the conceptual ideas and stored them as values to each part of the block. Yeah, I didn't tell you exactly how I do it because that's a secret. But the thing is that that's the conceptual design. That's how you design a chain. You see, when you actually ask me how do you design a chain, the stupid part of question of this is that you don't really, when you design it, you always give some type of certainty and evaluation that can make sure others can earn or learn from it. Then you definitely gonna have enough values. Provide enough values for your customers, investors, but also provide values to yourself. And that's the key. Because what people really misunderstand is that they often mistake one thing. They often mistake money from values. You don't really get it. Because that's the thing. Because when you think about money, you think about profit, and then you immediately think about it is rental, or you think about it is actually interest. Or you think about compound interest, or you think about interest. You think about those financial plans. Or you're thinking about the percentage of share that you were given. But when you think about values, so what do you really think about? You think about how you transmit those values to what kind of values can the product actually build or create? And the key of blockchain is how do you transmit those values to the money? It has always been like that. And then once you can explain that, that's the key. And once I can explain that, I can explain how a distributed, valued, multi-layered, decentralized value system. And that's the key, that's the key answer that I give to Ryan, who is the one who is the CTO of Transform. And that's the plan that we are using if ever we're going to have this kind of collaboration. And also, I want to tell you, because I didn't, I never really tell you about what exactly is blockchain in 2030, but I kind of tell you, because if I'm building a technology, only recently received the first layer, although it's 20 million, it's a lot. The thing is that, what exactly is going to be 10 years later? How do you actually prove that that's going to work? Well, you want to prove it to work. You need to prove that what exactly is inevitable. The only thing that's inevitable on this story, the moral of this story, is that blockchain will be used as the fundamental, as the architecture of the future systems. And that's actually one thing that we know for sure. That's one certainty that we know for sure. And if you don't use that, 10 years later, you would be so outdated, and it's unlikely that you're going to provide any values to anybody. Thank you very much. That's my presentation.
龙鹏给我们带来了精彩的这个演讲啊。那我们最后一个 speaker 呢啊，大家等我们 Charles 讲完之后就可以提问了。那我们最后一个Charles 给我们带来的话题呢是这个魁北克挖矿深度分析。So our final speaker is still going to be Charles, and the topic he's going to present is in Quebec about the mining analyst. Okay, thank you. So welcome, Charles.
This won't be much easier. For me, it's much more relaxed. It's about, it's mining in Quebec, as everybody knows that. Like Nebula AI team based in Montreal, Quebec. So we are very lucky at the moment that the mining, AI computing, and the blockchain, three of them all in Quebec as the center. So, 最后一个话题对我来说相对比较轻松一点，因为他讨论的是在魁北克挖矿这件事情，相对来说呢，他没有那么高的技术含量，所以说回答问题没有那么费脑子。然后，因为我们是蒙特利尔的一个项目组，所以说我们在做区块链的时候，每一个做区块链团队多多少少都会从挖矿开始，所以我们对魁北克挖矿这块比较熟悉。那么，我们。那么，但是在魁北克挖矿呢，跟其他地方还是有一些不一样的特色，所以说我们会在这里给大家一个介绍。So with the mining, like we have five topics here. First is the cost about mining. What kind of cryptocurrency you would like to mine? Mining. What is the electricity price in Quebec?How does the infrastructure look like, and what is the risk of mining? 那么关于这个 topic 呢，我们会分成五部分来讲，因为这是一个入门的关于挖矿的问题，所以说我们不会讲特别specific 到魁北克的问题。那么它主要有关于挖矿的这些成本在。挖矿的话，如果哪些货币你可能会比较愿意去挖矿？还有魁北克的电力的价格，还有一些基础设施的搭建，以及挖矿的一些潜在的风险。Before we continue, how many people have been mining? Try mining? Good. It looks like even more than who has Bitcoin.Okay, so the cost of mining, like roughly those conditions, we've been thinking about that. First, the mining equipment cost. Mining farm building, we're talking about large scale mining. It's not a bio mining rig and put it in your garage or in your kitchen. Mining, no, that's not the case. The other thing is commercial mining. And the electricity price, and plus the cooling system you are thinking about.And also about insurance and maintenance. This part, you already experienced the last part, is quite different from people mining in other countries. Sometimes they don't ask you to have insurance or something like that. And my maintenance fee is also very interesting because considered in Montreal, the lowest salary is $11 Canadian. If you compare to India or other place or Russia, the price is different.So that's cost you need to add to your base cost. For the mining equipment, we are going to next slide, we are talking about how many different devices existing for mining. For mining farm building, you are thinking that if you want to buy a new acquire an existing or rent an existing one or build a new one, the price is quite different. I get lots of requests.Ask me, hey Charles, can you just find a location for mining? Not much, just 10,000 machines, so please zero money. Wait, not as simple as you think. Okay. And the electricity price for sure, one largest portion of the mining cost is based on electricity. And in Ontario, I know that it's ridiculous. If you want money, you can make it like a sports game for mining, but you cannot make it as business. The equipment cost is okay for Canada. In Canada, basically, everybody think about Canada, oh, this is cold, that's true. So one group of people, I suggest them think about the cooling cost. In Gibeon, we're fine. Usually Gibeon is 10 degrees even in winter, lower than Toronto. So we're happy with the cold. There was a French song called Mon pays est l'hiver, which means my country is winter. 我在这里说的一些关于挖矿的一些主要是说的是商业挖矿，而不是个人娱乐用挖矿。所以说，在你做商业挖矿的时候，会考虑到的是一些设备的消耗成本，一些挖矿的这些建筑成本，包括厂房啊之类的一些附属的设备，以及电力成本也是很大一部分。这就是为什么大家怎么说啊，加拿大电。 魁北克电很便宜，俄罗斯电很便宜。比如说中国某些地方水电很便宜，因为电力成本是挖矿的时候要考虑一个很重要的一个问题。然后呢，还有一个温度，因为你挖矿的过程当然热了，所以说你要花多少的热量来降温系统，可能会消耗你很多的钱。比如说我的小矿场现在已经开始中风空调了，虽然今天天还很冷。然后还有一些保险和一些维护费用。 那么保险的话，在中国可能保险不是个大问题，但在加拿大作为一个商业的 building， 你总归是要保险，而且保险分为两部分，一个是你的设备保险，一个是你的房屋保险。而且因为这是个很新兴的业务，你去找保险经纪的时候，他很有可能说告诉你我们公司目前还没有这个险种，而且也有可能别人听到你是挖矿公司保险费，蹭上去。然后还有一些维护成本，因为你知道加拿大人工肯定是比国内要。 贵，那么蒙特利尔好的比唐人街的工资要稍微低一点，所以说如果你想去挖矿，无论是从电费还是从人工考虑，我觉得你都应该去考虑去魁北克，而不是在唐人街挖矿，唐人街做 blockchain 就可以。So mining pipes. So basically, this is a three mining coin you can consider: Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Litecoin. So most people. When they're doing a mining, the first thing comes to their mind is for Bitcoin mining. And which is the most famous mining machine? Anybody knows? S9, right? Last year is S7, this year is S9. Maybe after 6 months it will be S11. Yeah, secondary is Ethereum. Actually, I'm a big fan of Ethereum mining. That's why Libra AI created. Because when we mining a lot with GPU, and we found that, why do you just mining hash? That's coming to AI. That's where it comes from. But we can go more details about why Ethereum mining is much better than Bitcoin mining. And the last one is Litecoin mining. So a lot of people was doing Litecoin mining. Litecoin is very close to Bitcoin. So usually the Bitcoin manufacturers also produce some Litecoin mining. But I know one of the biggest is not Bitcoin mining, produce Litecoin. So, 关于挖矿的话，一般来说你有三种货币，其实三种货币也是基本上就是 Coinbase 的主流币了。当然，现在你们也可以挖一种新货币，叫做 BCH， 对吧？比特现金、比特币、以太坊和莱特币。那么，比特现金和比特币其实可以通过归为同一类挖矿。那么现在是最主流的挖矿，大部分都喜欢买比特币挖矿。然后他们的设备一般叫做 S9。 最著名的矿机，那么在S9里面呢，是长成这个样子，它可以同时挖比特币和比特现金，你可以自由切换。那么谁会挖谁，最便宜挖谁的有人说矿工是最没有节操的，因为只要赚钱，我才不管你是比特币好还是比特现金好，能赚钱是几个，但有很多人，但做完钱之后的做法不一样，有人会把比特币换成比特现金，有人会把比特现金换成比特币。So this is the Antminer S9, which is most famous now for Bitcoin mining, but I forget another symbol, there is Bitcoin Cash. This miner can both mine in Bitcoin or Bitcoin Cash, according to what you need. And some mining pool even give you the freedom to auto-switch with mining. But what after you do get the Bitcoin Cash, some people will sell it, convert it into Bitcoin, and some people will keep it. And some people even converting the Bitcoin to Bitcoin Cash, I don't think very much. One of the most useful places for Bitcoin Cash is that you can use it for buy as money. And I think that's the only thing I can imagine to use BCH.
就是比特现金可以买比特矿机，那是比特现金的最大用处。
And Bitcoin, by the way, Bitcoin Cash was created by Bitmain. So another one is Ethereum mining. So Ethereum mining, now they have three different ones. And on top of that is the open air frame mining rig. So which usually we can put a homemade version, or actually there are commercial version, but most of this one is homemade. So the reason is that it's not easy for transportation. So if you want to make it commercial, usually people will use the second and third version. Let's go about third one. Third is the GPU miner provided by Bitmain. The price is around $2,000 to $3,000. And they are going by hashes. For first mining rig, how many cars do they have?
Eight
cars. So it's using RX 580 cars. So each one, the hash rate maybe 25 to 30, around that. So with eight of them, it will close to 100 mega hash. So the unit for the mining in Ethereum is a mega hash. So it's a mega hash rate there. So it's 200. And the last one is close to 180 hash. It's created by Bitmain. The middle one, that's the magic. This one was created by Bitmain a few days ago. The first batch is already sold out. That has the same capability as the G1 and G2, but it's only 80 US dollar. And the first one costs about 3,000 US dollars. But there's a six, you can see that the batch one. If you check their website, now it's batch two. I think it's also sold out. The battery price $1,800. Exactly the same thing. That's how Bitmain works. They're always working like this. So the first batch is cheap, second batch is expensive, third batch is more expensive. So this is Ethereum miners. You mentioned that the one in the middle is an ASIC miner. The difference from the one and after. Because those the first one, third one, they are GPU miners. 关于以太矿机，现在目前的话有三种。第一种叫做开放式矿机，基本上这种矿机在大家起步阶段是最容易使用的，基本上就是说你在家也可以制作，你只要拿一波显卡插上去，加上 GPU， 加上 CPU， 加上 主板，跟一台电脑其实没有什么区别，唯一区别上就是多了个头槽。它其实本质上就是一台电脑，它有 Windows 系统，它有光图系统，可以选择你喜欢系统来进行挖矿。当然了，你自己去做的话，可能花三天三夜，最后还能把它整出来。 网上有什么教程？那么第三个呢是工业化的设计，是比特大陆生产的，G72矿机。同样两台熊猫矿机，你可以看到它是全封闭式的矿机，所以说它的声音噪音一定很大。如果你放在家里的话，你耳朵会有问题。它们的那个分贝是50-80，在70-80以上。那么中间一个是很神奇的一款矿机，它们前几年才发的，叫做E3矿机。 E3矿机的话，它的首批售价是$800，那么最新的一款，那最新的一代是最新的一个 batch 是这周出现的，价格已经涨到$1800。它的计算能力跟下面的 GG2其实是差不多的，但 GG2售价可能在$2000到$3000之间，所以你可以看到这个 ASIC 矿机它的计算能力几乎是一样，那价格只有1/3左右。 所以说它对市场是很大的冲击，但是呢，它这个机器的发售时间是交付时间是6月，所以我们也不知道6月会发生什么，可能维塔利克会把以太坊进行一次分叉，然后这些矿机就变成垃圾，这是最大的意思。So I forgot to mention that if Vitalik is not happy about the ASIC miner, he can fork it like what he did with the ETC from ETC to ETH, then you can receive, because those E3 miner will be delivered to you around June. So if that happens, you can receive a whole bunch of garbage.
Can be upgraded. If we
deprecate,
you can change the software and
then again. Because ASIC miner is hardware. The algorithm was burned in the hardware.
It's EEPROM, right? It's EEPROM. You can like upgrade
the iOS. It depends on how can they change the algorithm. If it's still harsh, equal harsh, that works fine, but how about you don't know. Or if they make it more, I hope they don't change the host. Then that will end up with everything. This is a Litecoin. It's a Litecoin miner, C1H, the very famous one. It's doing the Litecoin mining. I don't know this price because I'm not a big fan of Litecoin. So, 第三种矿机叫做莱特币矿机。 那么它这个矿机呢，最著名的厂商叫银鱼矿机。 但是我个人不是莱特币的粉丝，所以我也没打算去做任何莱特币。 在我早期的做 trading 的历史里面，莱特币是我唯一以前的币。 而且莱特币，我记得在2015年的时候，它的价格曾经从380人民币一直跌到5块钱，跌到连电费都付不起。所以我不希望这件事情发生在我的身上。 But just let your heart be true, you will, you like it. So this is the electricity price in Quebec. So you can see that this is we get it from the website from Hydro Quebec. You can check it like their web paper. So this is the LG plan, so large power. If you can consumption your billing, it's more than 5 kilowatts, which is 5 megawatts. You can, if you need more than 5 megawatts, this is the price you're going to be charged. So the energy price is 3.42 cents, which is quite cheap compared to Ontario. But there was one thing you need to be careful with demand charge. Very probably it says $13 per kilo. What is that? That's a monthly payment you have to pay plus the energy price. So if you divide it by 30 days, then by 24 hours, it's around 2 cents. So actual price of the money in Quebec is 5.4 cents. It's still very decent compared to Ontario, right? I think all the Ontarians or Torontos are very familiar with the Hydro One story. So, in Quebec, the cost of mining is 3.4. This is not per ton. If you add the demand charge, every month per kilowatt, $13, then the price, you divide 24 by 30 days, you can easily get a result. 每一度电的价格大约是在5.5分，这是加分，所以相对来说人民币的话，加分就低了，所以人民币的话可能还不到3毛钱，比起国内某些地方甚至还有更高的成本。 And what is most interesting is the next step, data center. This is the data center price in Quebec. Building data center in Quebec, the price only $2.5. 2.5 cents, that is 30%, or even half of the price of industry price. So, if you can make a data center, somebody guys will make using the data center for mining, like an example, this price will be get. Yeah.就是在河北的话，如果你用，如果是建设中心的话，出一通工薪的成本，大约电费是2.5分。 那么基本上你们耳熟能详的所有的云计算公司都在这里，这也就是NVIDIA AI 为什么 base 在 Quebec 不移动的原因。如果我们想获得我们数据中心的话，我们根本就不用去任何地方，我们有我们的 AI center， 我们有我们的 AI 的人员，我们有我们的数据中心，我们几乎要的所有的资源都可以在 Quebec 获得，我们没有去别的地方。所以 Quebec 会是永远会是我们的研发中心。 Yeah, I was saying that according to this graph, can easily get a conclusion that in Quebec, NVIDIA AI get all the resources they need. The AI center, engineers, and the data center, hardware, everything. We get everything there. That's why NVIDIA AI has a very big advantage compared to any other people want to do AI and blockchain. Oh, I forget to mention that one of the most influential guy in AI, Yuchao Ingo, is from Intel. He's working in Intel now. AI 这一方向的三大奠基人之一的 Yuchao Ingo 教授，他现在是在蒙特利尔大学执教，所以我们正好也在蒙特利尔。我在群，我也许以后有望成为巨人肩膀上的一个小孩子。This is how the commercial mining building looks like. I took the photos from the Google, so don't worry about it. I think some companies confidential, but you don't know it's from Google. You can see that these are many rigs. S9, or maybe S7. So for Bitcoin mining, it's very well organized. And you can see the big fans there, right? Those four big fans is for pumping the air through the mining facilities. It's not like you imagine using air conditioning. No, it doesn't work. They blow the air away. 这个就是在挖矿的房中间内部一样，你可以看到它跟超市一样，里面放满了矿机，然后在两端它有巨大的通风用的风扇来把空气抽走。把热气抽走，完全循环。所以说，你的外面的空气越冷，你降热效果越好。啊，亏得好冷的。this is the bigger man from outside. Look at this. It's a very flat. I think in Canada we call it bungalow. I'm not sure if in Ontario we call it same name. Yes. Okay. This is actually bungalow.Warehouse. 那么这是比特大陆的一个挖矿的矿房的外观，它其实是一个很扁平的结构，你可以想象这上面插满了通风风扇，中间全部都是 mining 的，就是挖矿的矿机架，就这样行。
风扇是前后走的，
它可以是两侧面，也可以前后。
可以看它侧面有透光吗？
它照片比较黑。它肯定是有，否则的话，它不可能做到。但也有室内工作的也是做到。
对的，
可能好一点。So now we come from the last part. What's the risk of mining? Easy thing, right? Mining machine has life cycles. The life cycle is not just because the machine is broken. It's also about the technology upgrade. Right. When S9 was coming, S7 had a very less profit. With today's price, S7, no value at all. Because it costs too much energy. The price, the cost for the energy cannot even match the price you mine. The coin mine, then it doesn't work. Why are you mining? Then, the electricity price changes. So, getting it is okay, but it's also happening when government changes the price of the electricity. But with other problems in Canada, it's even worse. It's when you sign a contract, with the electrical factories. How much they charge you this year, and the next year, probably you change. And you have all the facilities, you have all the buildings and mining rigs there, and you tell me to change the price, I cannot move. I lost money, right? And the third and the most scary thing is about cryptocurrency jobs, right? Bitcoin was about $20,000 several months ago. Nowadays, it's not even $9,000. So people are like, $7,000 now? $8,000 now? That's because we are lucky. The price just increased 2 days ago before we started the conference. Otherwise, it would have been $7,000. So you can easily lost everything when the price was making like this. Right? The only thing you can do is that you hold the money, right? The ones sold those currencies. Like, can you really go sell it? Do you really have the choice? You have to pay the electricity. You have to pay the employee salary. You have to pay the rent. You cannot stay there and say, okay, I keep the coin, I just don't sell. No, imagine that. When you're doing this facility, your daily cost is not $10,000. not just $100, right? You cannot see that. It's millions of dollars cost. You pay so such amount of money. So that's the three biggest risks you might encounter before you go to a commercial mining. For personal mining, it's fine. I lost one coin. So, 我现在在说的就是关于挖矿的风险。其实挖矿有好几个方面。 第一方面是机器的生命周期，以比特币矿机每隔一两年就会升级换代，哪怕是机器是好的，但是因为科技是换升级换代，它会导致你上一代矿机完全没有收益。也就是说，如果你挖矿不能在它升级换代周期里获得收益的话，你是永远不能回本的。我们升级周期可能是一年，可能是两年，可能完全取决于大家怎么玩。如果有那么多科技公司都非常快的升级硬件的话，你不想可能也得淘汰。 因为说实在的，当这些比特币矿机淘汰之后，它们唯一有用可能就是风扇和万贝壳。那么电费可能会变的，在魁北克还好一点，因为魁北克电价统一价。但是如果你是在其他的市场挖矿，你可能只是电厂，电厂今年给你交价格或者明年还给你交价格，就你要对电厂有好的关系。那么你到底有多少关系，就取决于你如何去送货了。那么第三点也是最可怕的，就是数字货币价格变化。 以来特币为例，在2015年的时候，来特币跌到5元的时候，挖矿的成本好像是7元，你挖还是亏？你挖也有亏，你不挖你也是亏。那么在这个时候，你一个大问题就是说，你还是有房租要执行，你签的那些合约你还是要执行，那么这时候你用什么去执行？ 而且你想想看，作为一个挖矿的人，对吧？我既然挖矿挖出来矿，肯定会多卖点，会留一点。那么如果你正好是在高点的时候没有卖掉，到了低点的时候，你正好有大笔单能要付，你必须要把你高点买攒下来的矿以低价去卖掉，回箱当炭烧，是吧？So that's the risk I'm thinking about. So if you are still interested in mining in debit, well, what I say is that welcome to debit. Thank you, everyone.
<音>好，那个观众朋友们，我们刚刚建了一个微信群哈，大家可以加一下啊，就是面对面建群，然后04144，就是今天的日期04144，面对面建群04144哈。如果你有这个微信的话 ，So everyone, if you have WeChat. We just built our group. The number to join is 0414, which is our date today. And all our speaker will be in the WeChat group, and they can answer the question for you. And for now, it's Q&A time. So if you have any question, feel free to ask. All the speakers are still here. So if you have question, please raise your hand up. Okay, yes.
Sure, sure. Yeah, I have a question to after regarding the report. Because I know I didn't see the how I can get the initial amount of my fair currency. After, yes. Yeah, how that, I see the demonstration at the initial phase, I already had $100 in my balance. How can I transfer my $100 to the Linkcoin platform?
So you mean you don't transfer your own money onto
the platform? No, I want to transfer, but I did not see how to do that. Should I do it with the online payment, with my credit card, or from my
So for our website, we don't take any like currencies like Canadian dollars or Chinese dollars on our website.
Yeah, this is my question. So how I can buy the other
Or if you just trade with the other person directly. So for example, so if you are a buyer, to buy a website, you want sorry, let me just come out here. If you are a buyer, you come to my website, you want to buy like a Bitcoin.
Any Bitcoin.
Let's say Bitcoin. So $1,000. We just find a seller that sells Bitcoin on their website, and then you pay them directly. So let's say
Let's sound some private transaction.
Private transaction, yes. So it doesn't go through. No, but like I said before, we will be locking up all the cryptocurrencies on our website. So let's say if you want to buy $1,000 without Bitcoin, from me, I have to make sure I have that much of Bitcoin on the website before I can sell it to you. So in that way, if you want, after you pay me, you will be able to get the coin.
Yeah, but I have to find someone that
needs
service.
Yeah, so that's what we do on our website. We provide this platform, and then you can come here and then find sellers. There are different sellers on the website.
Yeah.
And then you just go find the one you trust or the best price.
I do email transfer or WeChat transfer.
Exactly, That's right, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
No problem, thank you for your question. Any other questions? Anything, like either to me or to Charles. We're happy to answer. Usually it takes within 5 minutes for the whole transaction.
So I file the call 5 minutes and I want to sell in 5 minutes.
If you want to sell, that depends on how many people are buying, right? But if you are buying, you will be able to, as long as the other person is online, you will be able to get everything done within 5 minutes.
When the price of the chain
Yeah, so in terms of the price, thank you for bringing that up. So on our website, actually our price, there are two different ways you can set up your price. So if you are selling Bitcoin on our website, first you can either set up like a fixed price, which the price won't change, doesn't matter what happens to the market. The second one is that you can set up like a market price, and then also you can add on a premium to that. So let's say the price is $8,000 right now, and then you can add 10% to that. So that rate will change, just depends on the market price. We are calculating the price for the market based on all the different major exchanges, and then the price fluctuates every 10 minutes. Anyone else have any questions?
Okay, I think
this gentleman has a question here.
Hi, I'm Mr. Charles. So, we already have a mining field and for Ethereum. So, if we want to plug in into a network, well, what we need to do?
Yeah, basically, like our mainnet will be launching around September or maybe earlier. After that, there will be official. Documentation about how to install a software on top of your mining rig, Windows version or Ubuntu version. And for some ASIC miners, it may be possible also publish plugins for them as well. For example, the Bitmain Saffron platform, we already started research on it to see how it can integrate with our system. But basically, you can think about, say, like you're doing your Bitcoin mining or Ethereum mining, you download the software, you start the program and start mining.
Okay, sense.
Okay, here's the question.
I still have a question regarding the proof of work.
Yeah.
So how do you make sure that enough computing power is dedicated to the proof of work instead of they are dedicated to AI computing?
Yeah, that's something when we planning in the beginning, we are taking consideration. That first of all, with the Helix, you don't have the choice. You're doing the mining and the ledger at the same time. But with Aurum, if you proof of work, there's only one ledger will be elect as a ledger. And also, when you a new equipment start mining, you're actually not mining, working, you need to select which group you join. Usually, you choose the one close to you and you join to the network. And with the other markers, they have to. The ledger is, let's assume we have N workers or machines inside the group, right? So the ledger amount will be more than one but less than N. So with the Helix, you can think that N is equal to K, which is the ledger number, which means everyone is a ledger. But with Aurum, it's between one to N. So you have less, but you also have backups. to prevent that just in case one laser was offline and nobody will take his work.
How do you prevent the
level attack,
the
50% of attack? It's why I said that the group, there should be lots of minor or micro groups, right? So you have enough groups inside with each groups that have one ledger. This is something that like the light network or sharding, right? Inside the network, we don't think about those ones, but among the different networks, you have the ledger each over there doing the backup, so there's still the DPFT concern. Okay.
Any more questions? OK, so I realize that no one joined the group, just one more time. 所以你的微信呢上面有一个加号，点那个加号，然后发起群聊，然后里边有一个面对面建群，然后0414就进群了。好，谢谢。然后大家还有别的问题吗？好的，那我们今天的这个讲座就到此结束了。非常感谢大家参加我们本次讲座。那大家可以扫一扫我们这个 Newton AI 和 Lincoln 的这个微信公众号，然后关注他们的，持续关注他们的活动以及他们的平台以及项目。好，谢谢大家。
据我所知，是卖的。 曹毅，你不去吗？
我在这边来。
站中间，站中间。啊，对，他是我们做 AI 的啊。不是，有的是，这都是我们 AI blockchain 还有那什么。先看这个吧，先看这个。这里边有多少是从这边来的？有四个，我这是得有四个，我们的有四个。
我再两个这么高的，会拍脚吗？拍脚，谢谢。哎，汤米，汤米，这太高了，站远点。汤米，上来。好，蛮高的。对啊。应该把这拉到最中间。搞到中间吧。这边也搞，这边的也。Yeah, Tony is our chief blockchain developer.
One, two, three. One more, please. Okay, one, two, three. Great. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys. Well, yeah, no, of course, a lot of support.